Hi, I am Francisco. In part 1 of this video, we visited the laboratory of Dr. Anton Windfelder. There we introduced you to the tobacco hornworm, Manducasexta, as a fantastic animal model. Now it's about the keeping and breeding of these animals, and we will also show you why the caterpillar, the hornworm, is so suitable as a food animal. Enjoy the video! Before we really get started, some important information for you. As you can see, I'm standing here in the middle of a tobacco field, and there's a good reason for that. The tobacco hawk moth, Manducasexta, lives in certain parts of the US and other countries of North, Central and South America. It is a feared pest there, for example in tobacco fields like here. If specimens were to escape into nature outside their natural range, it would have devastating consequences. Not only would they be very harmful to tobacco, but also to other nightshade plants in general, such as tomatoes or potatoes. That's exactly one of the reasons why we really wanted to make this video. When online providers or sellers on terrarium fairs offer this species, mostly they don't really point out the enormous potential of this species, if it could actually establish itself in nature outside its natural range. For this reason, it is important to point out that if you keep these animals, under no circumstances should any eggs, caterpillars or even hawk moths get into nature. So that means if you actually want to keep these animals, then you have to be sure that you can bear this responsibility, that you can ensure that not a single animal can escape, and only then can you consider to keep and breed these animals. Let's say you bought a batch of eggs from a breeder. They are nice and green, as you can see here, and you can store them in a small plastic box with a ventilation area made of kitchen paper until the caterpillars hatch. Development is super fast and the caterpillars hatch after just 3 or 4 days. Then food must be ready immediately. If you wish to keep this species just for fun, you can of course feed them with all kinds of nightshade plants. For example, the leaves of the tomato plant. However, you will need to have a lot of them available because each caterpillar needs a leaf area that is larger than a letter-sized paper to develop. If you feed them such foliage, the caterpillars will become bright green, but also poisonous because of the toxins from the plants they store. So you can't feed them to your terrarium animals. If you don't have a lot of foliage from nightshade plants, or if you also intend to use the caterpillars as feeder animals, then you can also raise them on artificial food alone, like here. Then they turn turquoise blue. In the US, such food is produced by various suppliers. If you cannot get any, you have to make the food yourself, but it's not too difficult. Here you can see a perfectly suitable raising box for the caterpillars. As you can see, air holes on this side and also on the other side for good air exchange. Then you take such a grid for the caterpillars. This is so that the animals can sit on top and do not have contact with their droppings. Perfect setup for them. Here we now have our own artificial food according to our own recipe. And you can easily put 10 hornworms in here. I'm going to put 5 in here. If you have smaller ones, then of course you can put in a lot more, 20-30 hornworms, they don't mind. The only thing they care about is getting fat and getting big. Nevertheless, when they get bigger, it is of course better if you have several such boxes, so that they don't molest each other. You can see here the droppings are now at the bottom, and all the animals can be at the top of the grid. They have now eaten all the food, so you can simply take the grid out and put it in a separate box here. There's another one sitting there. And now you can easily clean the box. When it's finished, simply put a grid back in and that's it. You see, it's super practical and more hygienic than having earth or something similar in there. Here you can see what giant creatures they are. Look here, my finger in comparison. Those are giant hornworms. And they look super cool too. So futuristic with that blue and the dots and the white. So not only suitable feeder animals, but also really beautiful animals. Almost too good to feed them to your terrarium animals. As you can see here, the caterpillars grow really huge, up to 3.9 inches long and weighing up to 0.56 ounces. The caterpillars go through a total of 5 larval stages. At 77 to 80.6 degrees Fahrenheit, this happens extremely quickly. In just 20 days, a tiny larva has become a true giant. When the caterpillars have reached the maximum size, they stop eating. They then lighten and become slightly reddish or yellowish at the front. When this happens, and especially when you can clearly see the pulsating dorsal vessel like this, then you have to give the caterpillars a chance to pupate. In the laboratory, they are placed individually in small containers that are lined with some kitchen paper. That works quite well too. However, it is even better if the caterpillars can burrow like they do in nature. To make this possible for them, provide them with a substrate that is approximately 15 to 20 centimeters, so 5.9 to 7.8 inches deep and slightly moist. For example, you can use coconut substrate. The caterpillars then disappear very quickly, build a kind of chamber in the substrate and pupate in it. If you provided long days when rearing, which means at least 16 hours of light per day, the hog moths will hatch after around 3 weeks. Around this time, the pupae, which are initially light brown, become darker, almost black. You can then place them in a gauze flight, cage to hatch. The bigger, the better. Here you can see a newly hatched tobacco hawk moth. And here in time lapse, how it fully unfolds its wings by pumping hemolymph into its wings. Now I will show you how to keep the animals and what to do with the pupae when they are about to hatch. Put them on paper towels and then just put them here, in a gauze flight cage for butterflies. And now I will show you what it looks like. Well, actually every side is made of gauze, except this one, which is made of transparent plastic, so you can see through it. And the gauze is of course important, so that the animals can climb on it or so that they can hold onto it. Then of course you also have plants here. Only nightshades, of course. Here is sweet tobacco, from which they can also drink the nectar and also lay eggs on. And back here I have an angel's trumpet, which is also a nightshade plant. And that's where they lay their eggs to. But that alone is not enough. That's why you have an artificial feeder for them here too. I will show you how it's made. Around here it's just a paper towel. It's not that important. But inside there is a plastic tube and you fill it with 30% honey and the rest is water. Then you can place an artificial flower like this on top and then put a droplet of bergamot oil on the flower. That attracts the moths and so they find the feeder easier. You can just put it in and then they will drink from it. The whole setup here is super fun, super cool and absolutely exciting. Especially at night, you can really hear how everything is buzzing here. They fly like a hummingbird. They hover in place. You can also take photos if you are into it. They are really well suited for it. When they fly, the wind really blows. That's how much power they actually have. So it's so much fun with the animals. It's really great. Now I will take you into the cage. Here you see where they lay their eggs. I will show you the moths in a little more detail. So here you can see everything is full of eggs. They are super cool, they are greenish, and you can see the hawk moths. Super cool animals. Look, you can really pick up these two. I will put it back. You see, these are great animals. And many people don't even have the species on their mind, because who thinks of a butterfly or a moth like that when it comes to the terrarium hobby? No one, right? But they are also super exciting animals. Look there. And it's always a cycle. They lay eggs, the caterpillars hatch, and here again you have the pupae and so on. The hawk moths not only lay their eggs somewhere on top, but mostly under the leaves. So you can always turn the leaves over like this, and then you will see the underside is full of eggs. The hawk moths hold on here, and then they bend their bodies like this, around the leaf like this, and then they lay their eggs there. These animals are actually kept for mainly two reasons. Firstly, as normal terrarium animals, simply to observe and to enjoy. So then you can leave everything as it is here. The hawk moths lay the eggs, the caterpillars hatch out of the eggs, and then you will have the pupae. Then hawk moths again. So a cycle like that. And the caterpillars can simply eat the nightshade plants here. Of course, you have to keep adding new plants frequently. The second reason is that you want to feed the hornworms to terrarium animals. In this case, it is important to note that they will become indigestible for the animals when they eat these nightshades. Nightshade plants always contain toxins. For example, in tobacco, it is nicotine. Or in tomatoes, tomatidine. In potatoes, solanine, and so on. It's always a poison. And if they eat it, then your gecko doesn't want to eat the hornworm anymore. And that's the reason why we use an artificial food for them. And here you go looking for Easter eggs again and again. You look for the eggs and collect them because the hornworms that hatch from them, once they have got used to these plants, it is difficult or actually impossible to get them used to the artificial food. Therefore, collect the eggs straight out and then feed the hornworms right from the start with the artificial diet you have prepared for them. Here I have a little box and you can now pick the eggs and put them in there. Do it gently, just take them off with a bit of caution. Then you can turn the next leaf. You see that everything is full of eggs. They also bounce like bouncy balls. So you see, just collect them. See if you got all of them, then you can move on to the next leaf. Look, there are a lot of eggs. Be very careful. On the video, it looks like I'm going to crush them completely, but that's not the case. So here are the pupae. The hawk moths hatch after about 3 weeks. And then you have beautiful moths here. If you have the impression that one of them can't find the food, you can also feed it by hand. Simply place it at a food source, carefully unroll its proboscis, for example with a sharp wooden stick, and dip it into the food. Then the animals immediately start sucking. Now let's talk about the hornworms as feeder animals. As I said before, they are very well known and sought after in the hobby. Many different terrarium animals love the hornworms. As you can see here, this starts with the newly hatched caterpillars. You can, for example, offer these to small offspring of frogs, lizards, or also spiders. Larger caterpillars are suitable for larger terrarium animals. So, that's it for now in a nutshell about the tobacco hawk moth. Please make sure you check out the first part of this video too. Apart from that, you can find lots of other terrarium and herb videos on our channel. They are in German but with English subtitles. I hope you enjoyed the video. See you next time.